in the presence of the Lord, eyes are closed and heads are bowed. Our Father, our God, Lord, we give you praise and glory for another chance to enter into your presence. Now, Lord, as we approach this sacred moment of preaching, we pray, Lord, for a fresh enablement, a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. Cause me to decrease so that you might increase within me. Grant me, Lord, thine spirit and power divine. I pray, Lord, just one thing. You get glory out of everything we do and everything we say. Use me tonight to speak to some heart that may be heavy, to speak to some mind that may need to be regulated, to speak to someone's burdens that may be too heavy for them to carry. Tonight, I pray, Lord, that you would anoint these lips of clay, that I might speak words of spirit and life. Lord, I pray tonight that you would send the kind of grace that allow us to have experience that will yield fruit for the rest of our lives. I pray, Lord, that you would encourage our hearts, that you would enlighten our minds, that you would give us strength, that you would give us mercy and peace. My request, Lord, I ask now that you would give me preaching power, not for fame nor for reputation, but to the end that every man may see you more clearly, come to love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly. That the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. I ask it all in the excellent name of him who died on the cross, was buried in a grave, but rose from the dead. The Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. And every believer who's in love with Jesus will say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Will you put your hands together tonight and help me bless the Lord? For the Lord is good. His mercy is all for us. Tonight, the angel of this house, the pastor of this church, Pastor Kyle Sylvester, will you help me thank God for him and the blessing it is to be here tonight to share with you in this revival meeting. I am honored and I'm privileged to have another chance to share with the people of God the sweetest thing I know, which is the word of the living God. For the music staff, pianist and drummer, and your voices have lifted praises to our great God. Tonight is good to be here, and it is a joy to share in this service. Let's go now to the Word of God, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 5 through to verse number 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 5 through to verse number 9. And I'll read from the New King James Version of the Bible. This is how my Bible reads. It says, "Now I will come to you when I pass through Macedonia. For I am passing through Macedonia, and it may be that I will remain or even spend the winter with you, that you may send me on my journey wherever I go. For I do not wish to see you now on the way, but I hope to stay a while with you if the Lord permits. But I will tarry in Ephesus until Pentecost. For a great and effective door has opened to me, and there are many adversaries. But I will tarry in Ephesus until Pentecost, for a great and effective door has opened to me, and there are many adversaries." You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord shall stand forever. I want to preach tonight from this subject about open doors and adverse conditions. Open doors and adverse conditions. Hamilton maybe says that a kite rises against the wind instead of with the wind. Those who fly airplanes suggest that the takeoff is always better when they take off against the wind instead of with the wind. Somehow it is the opposing push of the wind that gives both the kite and the plane its lift. So it is for the believers, a healthy view of opposition, a healthy view of adversity, is that many times it is the adversity that we face that literally push our lives and ministry to a whole new level. Paul shares that with us in his experience here in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. The background is there in Acts chapter 19. Now Paul has begun to effectively preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul there in Ephesus has begun to share with them that there is only one way to salvation, that it is by faith alone in Christ alone. There in Ephesus was an idolatrous type of worship. There were a temple that was dedicated to the goddess Diana, and they worshiped Diana as if she was God. Well, Paul began to preach against this idolatry. Also there in Ephesus was a silversmith by the name of Demetrius. And Demetrius sold these silver shrines of the goddess Diana. The people there in Ephesus, they bought these shrines, they honored Diana. Well, Paul shows up there in Ephesus, and he begins to preach to them against this belief in a goddess, Diana. Paul posed the question to them, why would you serve a God that needs help to be God? Why would you serve a God that needs some public transportation? Why would you serve a God where if your God fall off of the statue, that you got to reach down and pick your God up? Why would you serve a God wherein if your God gets dirty, you got to take out a napkin and clean your God up? Or what if your God falls to pieces? You got to take your God and put the pieces of your God back together. Let me just park there and say, I don't need no God like that. I need a God that can pick me up when I fall. I need a God that can clean me off when I get dirty. I need a God who can carry me. I need a God who can look out for me. Paul says there is no gods that are made by hands. There is one God. He is the Lord God. I know that we live in an age now of religious pluralism. I know we live in an age now of postmodernity where we say that all of the beliefs of the world is all the same, and ultimately we all are going to the same creator God. I beg to differ. I want to suggest, children of God, that there is no God like the Lord God. There is no God like the Lord God, Jehovah. You can have Buddha, but give me the Lord. You can have Zoroaster, but give me the Lord. You can have Mary Baker Eddy, but give me the Lord. You can have John Russell, but give me the Lord. You can have Krishna, but give me the Lord. You can have Nero, Tiberius, but give me the Lord. Because all of those post-Calvary participants in history lived and died and still did. I don't need to tell you, the good news is that our Lord died on a cross. He was buried in a grave. But somebody tonight ought to be able to celebrate the fact that he didn't stay dead on early Sunday morning. Paul says there is no gods that are made by hand. There is but one God. He is the Lord God. Well, because people started believing the gospel of Jesus Christ, they stopped going to the temple of Diana. They stopped buying these shrines of Diana as if she was God. And because people stopped buying the shrines of Diana, the meat
Paul, he's got options to leave because it's difficult there in Ephesus. But Paul teaches us several things here about open doors and adverse conditions.
Yeah.
He first of all shares with us that open doors and adverse conditions are unscheduled. They are unplanned. Because Paul's plans were to leave Ephesus. His plans were to get out of Ephesus and pass through Macedonia and go to Corinth and spend the entire winter there in Corinth. But Paul says, out of nowhere, God changed my plans. Out of nowhere, God opened a door for me right here in Ephesus. And even though I had desires to leave Ephesus, Paul says, God interrupted my plans. I wonder, is there anybody here tonight who can testify that you understand what Paul went through? Because there have been times in your life when you thought you knew what was best for you, but somehow God changed your plans. And can I tell you, church, when God changed your plans, your attitude's got to be like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Nevertheless, not my will, but Lord, let your will be done. And anybody tonight can thank God that there have been times in your life where God changed your plans. Oh, yeah, if God wouldn't have changed your plans, you would have lost your mind. If God wouldn't have changed your plans, you would be unemployed. If God wouldn't have changed your plans, you would have married that fool. You better thank God he changed your plans. He said it was unscheduled. It was not a door that I was looking for or that I anticipated, but God changed. He interrupted my plans. I remember when I was a little boy, I would put together jigsaw puzzles with my daddy's sister. My Aunt Alice and I would sit at my grandmother's table and we would work on these jigsaw puzzles. And I remember this one particular evening, I had this piece to go on the puzzle. And I said, Aunt Alice, this piece goes right here on this puzzle. My Aunt Alice said, no, baby, it don't go there. I said, yes, it does. She said, no, it don't. I said, yes, it does. She said, no, it don't. So I took the piece and I forced it on the puzzle. I slapped it and said, you see, Aunt Alice, it fits on the puzzle. She said, well, you got the piece on the puzzle, but the picture ain't right. Come see, children of God, a whole lot of us are trying to force what is not in the will of God for our life, and we can't understand why, even though we got stuff to fit, that the picture just ain't right. It is because you got to learn to say, Lord, not what I want, but you want. Lord, not my ideals, but your ideals. You are in charge. Lord, have thy own way. It is unscheduled. He says, God changed my plans.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, children of God, we've got to go back to Big Mama's theology. I know you've graduated magna cum laude and summa cum laude. I know you've been robed in the colors of academic excellence, but some of us, our education has messed up our theology. Because Big Mama would always say, you remember Big Mama's theology, she would always say, I won't make plans until I conclude by saying, if the Lord says so. See, you're too smart to pick that up because you think you are in charge. You think you are in control. And that's the reason why you keep making a mess of your life, because you've got to learn to relinquish. Lord, I feel like preaching tonight. You've got to relinquish your control and say, Lord, you are the potter and I am the clay. Mold me, shape me, make me, break me. But it's what God wanted. And because it's what God wanted, I'm going to stay right here. I'm not going to be moved. I'm going to stay right here. I may have to cry, but I ain't going nowhere. I may have to give up the wrong for the right, but I ain't going nowhere. It may be hard. It may be difficult. I may be overwhelmed, but I'm not going to move. Why? Because easier for Paul to go to Corinth. Paul was loved by the Christians in Corinth. And though the Christians in Corinth couldn't get along with Paul, they couldn't get along rather with one another, there was at least a group of people who said, we love the Apostle Paul. But nobody in Ephesus was excited about Paul's being there. But Paul says, if it is God's will for me to be in Ephesus, I'm going to stay right here in Ephesus.
Yeah.
They are unscheduled open doors. And adverse conditions, they are unscheduled. But can I tell you further, they go together.
Yeah.
Are y'all walking with me?
Yeah.
They go together. Because there in verse 9, he says, a great and effective door has opened to me. But there are many adversaries. Notice he takes time to quantify his open door, but he also takes time to quantify his adverse conditions. He says, I got a great door. I have an effective door. It's a major door. It's a mega door. It's an extensive door. It's a large door that has been opened to me. He says, but there are many adversaries, which indicate to you and I that the greater our door is, the greater our adversity is going to be. If you want little attack in your life, just do little and be little, and nobody's going to bother you. But if you want to grab a hold of God-sized dreams and God-sized visions, get ready for some beatdowns. Get ready to be talked about. Get ready to be lied on. Get ready for your name to be scandalized. They're going to look you down and talk you down. They're going to make up rumors and lies. Don't show up with a new dress on. They're going to say, I know who bought that dress for her. Don't show up driving a new car. They're going to say, I know she's been sleeping around with the boss. Oh, what can I tell you? It comes with the territory.
They
go together. It once was said that if there is no adversity in the place where you serve, then chances are you're serving in the wrong place. Jeremiah had become weary and tired and burdened by the weight and demand of ministry. He began to cry and complain to God. And God responded to Jeremiah by saying to him, if you are weary by running with me and men, what are you going to do when you have to run against horses? If you are tripping about living in a plain land, what are you going to do when the Jordan swells up on you? In other words, if you can't handle a little heartache, you ain't ready for God-sized blessings. Because the fact of the matter is, as soon as God opens a door in your life, the enemy is going to come to do all that he can to antagonize you, to make you quit. But you got to say, enemy, you can hit me on the right side. You can hit me on the left side. I know who I am, and I know who I belong to. And if God be for me,
who can be against me?
They go together. He says, God has opened a door for me, and there are many adversaries. Can I tell you, children of God, the fact that the enemy gets busy trying to distract, deter, and redirect and impede the purpose that God has for your open door is an indication that that is God's place for your life. The fact of the matter is that every one of us have got to learn to thank God for the enemy's opposition. Because the truth of the matter is, the devil don't get busy messing with people who he already got. I know some people, their testimony is, I don't never have to go through anything. I know some people's testimony is, I don't ever have any problems. I don't have any hardships. It may be that you ain't doing nothing. Because the fact of the matter is, there are only two types of people who are in the kingdom right now. There are people who are busy doing stuff, and then there are people talking about the ones who are doing something. I know I'm preaching good. He says, I've got a great door. He says, but I also have many many adversaries. But then can I take you just a little further? This is what you've got to learn to celebrate open doors in adverse conditions, because God is in charge of the doors.
Yes.
Because a door in the life of a believer is simply a metaphor for an opportunity. And it is God who's in charge of the doors. Revelation 3:7 says, God opened doors that no man can close. And God closes doors. Lord, I feel good tonight. That no man can open. Is there anybody around this church tonight who can thank God for the doors he's opened for us? Oh yeah, you ought to be able to thank him tonight for the doors he's opened for you. You know you don't deserve to be where you are. You know you're not qualified for the positions that you hold. You know that there were people who had much more qualifications than you. But look at how God opened the windows of heaven. How God poured you out blessings that you don't even have room enough to receive. And every one of us, when we come to church, we better learn to give God the glory. Because what you have, the Lord gave it to you. What you know, the Lord taught it to you. Who you are, the Lord made you that. And if you're going somewhere, the Lord has to take you there. He says, God opened doors.
Yes, sir.
And I thank God for the doors he's opened. But can I tell you, you also ought to learn to thank God for the doors he's closed. Because when God closes a door, it's not God's rejection. Sometimes it's God's protection. And can I tell you, sometimes God has got to protect you from yourself. Because if you are not careful, you will go the wrong way. If you are not careful, you will make a drastic mistake. Because as far as you are concerned, most of the time, you judge stuff from the outside in. But God is not looking from the outside in. God is looking from the inside out. And so you've got to learn to thank God for the doors he's closed.
Thank you.
Notice he says it's God who opened the door, because he words this text in the present tense. This suggests to us that God opened the door right now.
Yes.
Somebody tonight, you are leaving believing that the door is already open. All you had the right church tonight who can testify, I don't have to go and look for the door to be open. Why? Because God opened the door and he left the door open. Somebody tonight will thank God that the door is still open, and all you got to do is walk through the door. You don't have to politic. You don't have to trip and run rumors and lies on somebody else's door. Why? Because what God has for you, it is for you. It has opened. It's already open. But then he says, it's opened to me. He says, it's my door. Can I tell you, church? You gotta learn to thank God for my door. I know we have a selfish congregation of people today where people only shout about what God is doing in their lives. Can I tell you, children of God, you got to learn to thank God for what he's doing in my life. Because if we are in the same family, if God blesses me, then that means he's the same God who's able to bless you too. I know you like to shout about the Lord adding favor in your life, but sometimes you got to learn to thank God for the favor in my life. I know you thank God for the blessings he's poured out